tree breaks and wildlife refuge as a policy. And I think we're getting all that, the manager now of tree breaks and wildlife, which is one of the biggest refuges in the country. Did I know what I'm talking about, the tree breaks area? I've been several, one time, another gentleman that I hired, now the manager, the refuge manager, Chris works for. And believe it or not, we started getting reproduction. And then I knew we were on a 100-yard dash, we'd got to 95. Did have mortality, that's Chris, by the way, and found that out because the radio collar wouldn't move. We had mercury switches in the collars. And when that mercury stayed in one place for more than 5 or 6 hours, something wrong. So if it stayed in there 8 hours, we went in and looked for the animals. Well, they could be asleep, but they move when they're asleep, and they move. Why would they? We did start finding mortality. But nevertheless, the project was a really good, successful project. Now, that's the last one on critical, I mean on highway approval. I'm trying to talk fast, I can't focus. The project has been determined to be successful, and it is actually working. But there it were. First time in known man's history. A predator like a wolf was reintroduced into an area where it had been gone for 2 other years. And again, I just thank the Lord because and he had to be involved in getting these wolves for some reason, one of those wolves by one. Now, another phase, it's in the grace of very quickly in the grace of the mountain. Park Service came to us because they saw what was going on down east. They wanted a share of that publicity. And so they asked us, asked me about the Red Wolf Project, our reintroduction in the Smokies. Now, to make a long story short, which I'm going to try to do, that's the director of the National Park Service in Washington on the lake. They actually bought wolves down. I'm afraid that's me standing there. We actually brought wolves down to Ridge Parkway National Park in the Cage Cove area and one or two other sites. I know they're all over there. And we built 10 50 by 50 foot pens and brought the wolves in. That's the superintendent of the park, by the way. In the Cage Cove. And we picked out release sites, and I think we released 5 or 6 pair of wolves. Part of them at least came from, had been to Alligator River Refuge for Bull's Island. I know these animals had been exposed for a while, living in the wild. And we bought them in the park and a radio called them that the capture crawled along and released them into these areas that I thought should be good sites for wolves. Because these areas are eaten up with ground hogs and raccoons and mussels. Pretty bad. Big prey base in the Cage Cove area. I'm sure all of you know where. In any event, that project, that's over this one. This project didn't succeed because I thought, based on information I had, was at the small mammal base in the park, near the park. With all that cold store and it had been like, there had to be a small mammal prey base for wolves to be on. But he knows something. These animals were literally starting to live. And the young pups were not surviving. So after 2.5 years or 3 years, we had second wolves. And this one is the most, to me, the most fascinating slide. It's the only picture in the world that I can find of three wolves killing a black bear. In cage cutting. I think that's the only picture in the world of wolves actually killing a bear. I may be wrong, but I want y'all to see the picture. Absolutely fascinating. Now, I'm trying to wind it down now. Park Service, after the Ridge Smoky Mountain National Park project, other components of the National Park Service got into wolves. And the Gulf Islands National Seashore came to me first and wanted to know if we could, in our captive breeding program, why keep them in a pen? Put them on an island. You know, how do you go about this study? That's a great idea. So bless Pat, and I'm going to make a long story short. We put wolves on several of the islands. And my last story, well, there we are, building the pens along the island. I forget which island this was. The island was eaten up with raccoons. If you just walk along and see raccoons croaking off everywhere, I mean, the place looked lovely. And I thought, well, boy, that's going to be a good prey base for wolves. But there was a little more to it than I realized. And I think that's the last one of them. No, there's wolves with one of the females with pups. That's real. That's the end of my story. But let me tell you very quickly about the island project, because it's something fascinating. The larvae sea turtles used to use those islands as that part of the component of the Gulf Islands National Seashore. But that was in the olden days. Somebody took raccoons out there and leveled them. I don't know what reason, but they took raccoons out there. This is like 15 miles offshore. And after about 5 years of that hiatus, the sea turtles quit coming in. I think you can see what's coming. We put wolves on that island, and they cleaned the raccoon population out. That was our only purpose, except for crabs and occasional fish that get washed ashore. Do you know that after about 5 years, the sea turtles started nesting again?